Welcome back, everyone. This is Mind Blank. Excuse my ragged voice, but today's focus point is the Ryzen 2400G, one of the two Raven Ridge CPUs AMD launched this week. And I've got here a retail chip since I didn't get sampled by AMD at launch date this time, but this shouldn't provide any different results to that of the official launch review samples. I'm going to skip the history lesson here and instead just focus on what has changed for this particular CPU. Most obvious is the addition of a dedicated on-die RX Vega GPU with 11 compute units, meaning 704 stream processors. It is clocked at a default 1250 MHz, which is really respectable considering that the entire CPU has a TDP of 65 watts. Like with all AMD APUs, this doesn't have onboard dedicated video RAM or any sort of embedded DRAM for that matter, and will entirely rely on the system's own RAM. Computer DRAM is designed to provide a good balance of both bandwidth and low latencies, unlike GPU VRAM, which is designed to provide massive bandwidth first of all. So this alone tells us that the speed your RAM will be running at will be very influential on Vega 11's performance. On the CPU side, there's three big changes. Raven Ridge is running only one CCX for its 4-core 8-thread setup, unlike any other desktop Ryzen CPU. Second change is that it only has 4 MB of L3 cache, and lastly, it's not soldered, it uses regular TIM probably in an attempt to reduce manufacturing costs like with previous APUs. This is a $169 priced chip and it kinda replaces the Ryzen 5 1400 at a similar price point. It comes with a 3.6 GHz base clock and can boost up to 3.9 GHz during loads. It is completely unlocked if your motherboard's chipset supports it, meaning any other chipset higher than A320, which should only allow GPU overclocking. Okay, so a word on testing. I'm using a Gigabyte AB350 Gaming 3 motherboard running UEFI F20. For all tests, I'm using an Arctic Freezer 33 eSports Edition cooler, an affordable heatsink that provides really nice temperatures at $40 price tag. I will be discussing temperatures on the provided RateStyle cooler at the end of the video. I'm also using the 17.7 beta drivers, which feel really early access in nature. This is Relive based and there's some features missing like Relive, but I'm confident AMD will give us Adrenaline drivers soon with all the nice improvements they bring. Let's discuss RAM and IMC. I'm using a kit of 16GB 3600 CL18 2020-20 single rank from Team Group. This is BDI, by the way. I didn't have ample time to fiddle with the timings and was interested in just running as high as possible of a frequency as I could get. And I topped out for now at 3466MHz CL17-18-18-18, 3600 boots, but is not stable currently. Now, this is a marked improvement compared to the 1500X, for example, which topped out at 2933. The CPU side, on the other hand, was less impressive, with 4GHz requiring 1.45 volts to be stable, but it was reachable as opposed to other Ryzen 5s that stopped dead at 3.9 GHz. So I stuck with 3.9 as 1.45 volts for 4GHz seems a rather high voltage for 24/7. I'm going to start with a few performance tests here, nothing special. I'm just checking out CPU-Z's single and multi-threaded performance at stock and clock-for-clock at 3.9 GHz with the Ryzen 1500X. And the missing L3 cache is not showing any performance deficit here, quite the contrary, which is interesting. Moving on to Cinebench R15, this is a more real-life test, at least for those of us using Cinema 4D. But things look pretty damn good with a respectable 861 Cinebench points and actually beating the 1500X clock-for-clock by a tiny bit. I'm also testing handbrake encoding, which is another typical type of workload. And nothing's really new here as compared to the 4-core 8-thread CPUs we've taken a look at previously, solid performance across the board, just a lot more added value on the 2400G side at the same price point. Finally, I'm taking a look at WinRAR's compression test and numbers are really bunched up here, having only a few seconds between all these configs. The only significant jump you can make in WinRAR is by doubling the core count. Right, so RX Vega 11 is the GPU that comes with the 2400G and is clocked at a default 1250 MHz. I'll be using 2 GB of allocated frame buffer for the GPU and will test stock with 3200MHz RAM running CL16 and overclocked to 1550MHz running 3466MHz CL17-18-18. For those 1550MHz tests, I'm also running the CPU at a locked 3.8GHz at 1.32V. I will be talking about the overclocking process after the test, there's actually some rather interesting info, but let's kick it off with CSGO. This is really amazing performance and when overclocked it's above GT1030 territory. 1080p medium pushing 160fps at stock. This already means that you can power a 144Hz 1080p monitor if you play CSGO intensively. This is one of the many tests that really impress and show what Vega 11 is capable when running a nicely optimized engine. Generally, there's not a lot of improvement from overclocking the GPU since it's mostly bandwidth starved, so clocking the memory higher is going to provide better results than raising the core clock. Next up is Overwatch and I am running 1080p medium with a 75% resolution scale. GeForce cards generally tend to perform better in this game, but at 86fps average you're going to have a great experience in both performance and graphics. Above 90fps while overclocked means that high refresh rate monitor combos are also a possibility for this game. I'm testing GTA 5 and seeing great performance at 1080p normal settings, even though the GT 30 is clearly ahead in this game. But frame rate is really stable and the game looks good at these settings, you can even up the textures to high if you want with no significant impact on performance. GTA 5, to be honest, has always been nicely optimized and I will show you something really special later in the video on what Vega 11 is capable of doing in this game. I've also tested Destiny 2 at low settings with 75% scaled resolution and getting respectable averages with some low 40fps dips during fights when overclocked. Also, when running overclocked, it matches the 1030. And at stock 1250MHz performance is still impressive and honestly, the game still looks good even at low. I wanted to test Rise of the Tomb Raider in DX12 to see how Vega 11 fares in a graphically demanding game and lacking in the optimization department. Overclocked, it reaches 1030 performance and provides a solid above 30fps experience at low, even at stock. I just capped the game at 30fps, up a few more settings to medium, and you can easily enjoy this game at 1080p. Finally, here's some Firestrike results, and these are the graphics scores only, and at stock we're looking at 3512 points, which is really close to the 1030. Though overclocked to 1550MHz, I was seeing 3851 points, which is around Radeon to 60 level, and approaching to 60x performance rapidly, except this is all integrated into the CPU. Now let's talk about overclocking. There's actually two methods to overclock, either directly specifying the GPU clock in the UEFI, or more conveniently, install Ryzen Master and you get access to all CPU and GPU clocks and voltages. The graphics voltage here, which is the Vega 11 core voltage, is the same as the chip SoC voltage, and maximum save voltage for the SoC, if you remember from Ryzen, is around 1.2 volts on air, and this generates more heat on the GPU side and the SoC side. One rather strange thing I found is some sort of throttling when overclocking the GPU, and I don't know if this is thermal throttling as the temperature really doesn't point to this, I mean we're talking low 50s on the Vega core, of course if temperatures are reported correctly. And this is actually the reason why I've stopped at 1550MHz at 1.16V, otherwise the GPU is capable of doing 1700MHz at 1.25V, but clocks drop down to 200MHz at regular intervals, and this will happen even at 1600MHz, 1.2V. It could also be a hard cap on current draw from the SoC VRM on this particular motherboard, or thermal throttle on the VRM circuitry, I'm actually not 100% sure at this point. Testing with the stock Wraith cooler, I wasn't able to go above 1450-1500MHz on the GPU depending on game, but this was while running the same 3.8GHz overclock. Also, CPU at stock with the Wraith on it got me around 54 Celsius in Overwatch in a 24C ambient, so there is OC wiggle room even with the provided heatsink. Total system power draw during Overwatch gaming when overclocked to 3.8 on the CPU and 1550 MHz on the GPU was around 135 watts, so you can power this with a quality Pico PSU even and it's going to be just fine. At stock, I was looking at around 100 watts total system power draw during Overwatch gaming. Finally, I want to take a look at how memory frequency affects iGPU performance, and I went from 2133 MHz up to 3466 MHz, always running in dual channel mode. You can clearly see how bandwidth starved the Vega 11 GPU is, and this brings me to the point of current feasibility of running high speed RAM. Actually, I've worded that bad since high frequency RAM prices are not the issue, it's all RAM that's affected by crazy prices. Cause going from 2400 MHz to 3200 MHz is not going to add more than 10% extra, but the cost is absurd to begin with. But leaving this aside, since hopefully RAM prices will drop to more manageable levels, the performance of this entire package is really, really impressive and empowers some $500 budget-friendly builds that have a great upgrade path and the potential to handle much more powerful dedicated GPUs thanks to the 4-core 8-thread Ryzen in here. In my opinion, GPUs under, at, or slightly above $100 no longer make sense now, meaning RX 550s and GT 1030s. And like I promised, here's some truly impressive stuff that Vega 11 can pull off. Yes, I just set the resolution to 3440 by 1440 and I'm running normal settings in GTA 5, and as you can see, it isn't rendered useless. Actually, I think this is even a bit above normal settings, at least the texture quality. The GPU is overclocked and running 3466 RAM, but this is out of this world for Andy graphics. Not convinced yet? Well, here's CSGO at the same 3440 by 1440 at medium settings, giving me 80 FPS with no issues. We're talking 80 FPS here, not 30. This is completely playable at this frame rate if you have an ultra-wide display, not capable of more than 60Hz anyway. And here's Overwatch at the same 3440, medium settings running with 50% res modifier. Yes, it is rendering 1720 by 720 in reality, but it's giving me 60 to 70 FPS on average. This is insane by all definitions of the word insane, and I can't help but wonder how an APU with 16 CUs and embedded DRAM would perform. So guys, thank you for watching this review and stay tuned for some Ryzen 2200G performance testing and overclocking. Meanwhile, don't forget to check out my Twitter, Instagram and Patreon pages if you want to become a Mindblank Tech backer. Thank you for supporting this channel by subscribing and I'll see you in the next one everybody, bye bye.